I Have a Special Plan for This World by Thomas Ligotti. I remember working in an office where the atmosphere of tension had become so severe and pervasive that one could barely see more than a few feet in any direction. This resulted in considerable difficulties for those of us who were trying to perform the tasks which our jobs required. For instance, if, for some reason, we needed to leave our desks and negotiate our way to another part of the building, it was not possible to see beyond a certain distance, which was, at most, a few feet. Outside this limited perimeter, this cocoon of clarity, as I thought of it, everything became obscured in a kind of quivering blur, an ambience of agitation within which the solid and dreary decor of the company offices appeared quite distorted. People were constantly bumping into each other in the narrow aisleways and high-ceilinged hallways of the Blaine Company offices. So severe was this state of affairs in which that atmosphere of tension at that place had caused any object more than a few feet away to be lost in a jittering and filmy tableau. One might glimpse some indistinct shape nearby, perhaps something resembling a face, which at best would look like a rubber mask. Then, suddenly, you found yourself colliding with one of your fellow office workers. At that moment, the image of the other person became grotesquely clarified in contrast to the otherwise blurry environment brought on by the severe tension, the incredible agitation that existed in the office and pervaded its every corner, even into the smallest storage room and the sub-basement of the old office building in which the Blaine Company was the only tenant. After one of those collisions between co-workers, which occurred with great frequency during this time of tension, each of the persons involved would quickly mouth some words of pardon to the other. Of course, I can only be sure about my own words. They were always polite expressions of self-pardoning, no matter how I actually felt at that precise moment of collision. As for the words that were spoken by the other person, I cannot attest, because these were invariably garbled or sometimes entirely lost in that same atmosphere of tension and agitation that obtained throughout the Blaine workplace. Even in the closest quarters, all exchanges of conversation carried only a few inches at most before they turned into a senseless babble or were lost altogether. But whatever these words might have been was irrelevant, for very soon you had collected yourself and were rushing off once again into the blurred spaces before you in the Blaine offices, trying to put out of your mind that intensely clarified image you had witnessed, if only for a flashing moment, that microscopically detailed eyeball, that pair of super-defined lips, or just a single one out of those lips. A nostril bristling with tiny hairs, a mountainous knuckle. Whatever you might have seen, you wanted only to drive from your mind as soon as possible. Otherwise, this image of some part of a human face or a human body would hook itself into your brain and become associated with the viciously tense and agitated state in which we all existed, thereby initiating a series of violent thoughts and fantasies concerning that eyeball or pair of lips, especially if you recognize the person to whom those parts were attached and could give a name to the object of your murderous rage. To a certain extent, the conditions I have described could be attributed to the management system under which the company was organized. It seemed evident that the various departmental supervisors and even upper-level managers operated according to a mandate that required them to create and maintain an environment of tension-filled conflict among the lower staff of the company. Whether this practice was dictated by some trend in managing technique or was endemic to the Blaine Company was a matter of speculation. But there was another and more significant reason for this climate of tense agitation under which we labored, a situation that, after all, is common to working environments everywhere. The reason to which I refer is this. The city in which the Blaine Company offices were located, in fact, had very recently relocated, had once been known, quite justly, as Murder Town. Hence, it was not unreasonable to conclude that the atmosphere of tension, of agitation, that at certain times severely affected the spaces of the building in which the Blaine Company was the only tenant, had its counterpart in the streets of the city outside the building. More often than not, the city, which had once been known as Murder Town, was permeated by a yellowish haze. This particular haze was usually so dense that the streetlights of the downtown section, as well as the vast decaying neighborhoods surrounding this area, were in operation both day and night. Furthermore, there existed a direct correlation between the murders that took place in the city and the density of the yellow haze which veiled its streets. Even though no one openly recognized this correspondence, it was a verifiable fact. The heavier this yellowish haze weighed upon the city, the more murders would need to be reported by the local news sources. It was as simple as that. The actual number of murders could most accurately be traced only in a tabloid newspaper called the Metro Herald, which thrived on sensational stories and statistics. The other newspapers, those which pervade a more dignified image of themselves, proved to be a far less reliable record of both the details of the murders that were occurring throughout the city and also the actual number of these murders. These latter newspapers also failed to indicate any link between the density of the yellowish haze and the city's murder count. True enough, neither did the Metro Herald draw direct attention to this link. It was simply a reality that was easier to follow in their pages than in those newspapers with a more dignified image, let alone the radio and television sources, which labored under the burden of delivering their information, respectively, by means of either a human voice or by a human head accompanied by a human voice, lending both of these media a greater immediacy and reality than their printed counterparts. The consequence of the heightened reality of the radio and television news sources was that they could not afford to report anything close to the true quantity or the full details of murders that were always happening. Because, if they did offer such reports by means of a human voice, with or without the presence of a human head, they would make themselves intolerable to their listeners and viewers, and ultimately they would lose advertising revenue because their audiences would abandon them, leaving only these human voices and heads reporting one murder after another without anyone listening to them or watching them recite these crimes. Whereas, the newspapers, with a dignified image, were able to relegate a modicum of such murder stories to the depths of their ample pages, allowing their readers to take or leave these accounts as they wished, while the Metro Herald actually thrived upon disseminating such sensational news to a readership eager to consume dispatches on the bleakest, most bizarre, and most scandalous business of the world. Yet even the Metro Herald was forced to draw the line at some point when it came to making known to their readers the full quantity as well as the true nature of all of the murderous goings-on in the city to which the Blaine Company had relocated, the city that was once known as Murder Town. Of course, by the time of the company's relocation, the epithet of Murder Town was no longer in wide usage, having been eradicated by a sophisticated public relations campaign specifically designed to attract commercial entities like the Blaine Company. Thus, the place formerly known as Murder Town had now acquired an informal civic designation as the Golden City. As anyone might have observed, no specific rationale was ever advanced to justify the city's new persona. The quality of being golden was merely put forth as a given trait, a new identity, which was bolstered in the most shameless manner in radio, television, and newspaper ads, not to mention billboards and brochures. It was something assumed to be so, as though goldenness, with all the associations attending this term, had always been a vital element of the city. Certainly, there was never any reference made, as one might have assumed, to the meteorological phenomenon of the yellowish haze that was truly the preeminent distinction of the physical landscape of the city, including the vast and decaying neighborhoods that surrounded it. In radio, television, and newspaper ads, across billboards, and in the glossy pages of brochures that were mailed out on a worldwide scale, the city was always depicted as a place with clear skies above and tidy metropolitan avenues below. This image, of course, could not have been more at odds with the city's crumbling and all but abandoned towers, beneath which were the streets so choked with a yellowish haze that one was fortunate to be able to see more than a few yards in any direction. I knew for a fact that a deal had been struck between the local bureaus of commerce and business, like the Blaine Company, which could not, for the sake of appearances, relocate their offices to a place whose second name was Murder Town, but could easily settle themselves in the Golden City. Nevertheless, it was this place, this haze-choked Murder Town, to which the Blaine Company had been attracted and which well suited, as I well know, its purposes as a commercial entity. Not long after the Blaine Company had relocated itself, a memorandum went out to all employees from the office of the founder and president of the company, U.G. Blaine, a person whom none of us, with the exception of some members of senior management, had ever seen, and from whom we had never received a direct communication of any kind, at least not since I had been hired to work in its offices. The memo was brief and simply announced that a company-wide restructuring was imminent, although no dates or details and no reasoning of any kind were offered for this dramatic action. Within a few months of the announcement of this obscure restructuring, the supervisors of the various departments within the Blaine Company, as well as a few members of upper-level management, were all murdered. Perhaps I might be allowed a moment to elaborate on the murders I have just mentioned, which were indeed unusual, even for a city that had once been known as Murder Town. The most crucial datum which I should impart is that every one of the murders of persons holding management positions at the Blaine Company had taken place within the Golden City on days when the yellowish haze had been especially dense. This fact could have been corroborated by anyone who had taken the least interest in the matter, even if none of the local newspapers, never mind the radio and television reports, ever indicated this connection. Nonetheless, it was quite conspicuous, if one only took the time to glance out the window on certain days when the streets outside were particularly hazy or particularly yellowish, what was in the works. Sometimes I would peek over the enclosure that surrounded my desk and look out into the streets thick with haze. On those occasions, I would think to myself, another one of them will be murdered today, and without exception, this would be the case. Before the day was out, or sometimes during the night, the body of another supervisor, and sometimes a member of upper-level management, would be found lying dead somewhere in the Golden City. Most often, the murders took place as the victims were walking from their cars on their way into work or walking back to their cars after the workday was over, while some of the crimes transpired when the victims were actually inside their cars. Less frequently was the body of a supervisor or someone of even higher rank within the company found dead in the evening hours or on weekends. The reason that far fewer of these murders occurred during the evening and on weekends was blatant, even if no one ever made an issue of it. As I have already pointed out, these murders always took place in the Golden City, and even needed to take place there. However, very few of the supervisors, and certainly none of the members of upper-level management, resided within the city limits for the simple reason that they could afford to live in one of the outlying suburbs, where the yellowish haze was seldom as dense and quite often not even visible, or at least not visible to the unaided or unobservant eye. Consequently, the victims had scant motivation to make an appearance in the Golden City after working hours or on weekends, for there was nothing, or very little, to attract anyone to this place, and many things that gave cause to avoid it, other than that this happened to be the location where one was forced to come to work. Yet these persons, who spent as little time as possible in the Golden City, were exclusively the ones, out of the large roster of those employed by the Blaine Company, to be viciously murdered there. Or so it was in the beginning. On some days, more than one supervisor's body would be discovered exhibiting the signs of the most violent physical attack, which often suggested the work of more than one assailant, although the crime scene otherwise suggested no evidence of a premeditated conspiracy or thoughtful planning. They all seemed, in fact, to be makeshift affairs. Sometimes they were crude assaults with whatever objects might have been close at hand, such as a fragment of crumbling sidewalk or a piece of broken window in a back alley. Often, the cause of death was simply strangulation or even suffocation in which lice-ridden rags had been jammed deep into the victim's throat. Quite often, it was just a beating unto death that left indications of more than one pair of pummeling fists and more than one kind of savagely kicking shoe. Frequently, the corpses of these unfortunate supervisors and the occasional member of upper-level management were stripped of their clothing, as well as robbed of their money and other valuable effects. This was typical of so many of the murders in the Golden City, a fact that could be verified by the many detectives who interviewed almost everyone at the Blaine Company in the course of their investigations of these crimes, which, in the absence of other peculiar facts of evidence, were attributed to the numerous derelicts who made their home in the city's streets. There was, of course, the salient fact, which did not escape the investigating detectives, but which, for some reason, they never saw as a relevant issue, that for quite some time, all of the victims who worked at the Blaine Company offices had attained the level of supervisor, if not an even higher position in the company. I doubt that the detectives were even aware that it was in the nature of a supervisor's function at the company to foment exactly the kind of violent and even murderous sentiments that would lead low-level staff to form images in their minds of doing away with these people. However, we tried to cast such imagined scenes from our minds as soon as they began to form. And now that all of these supervisors had been murdered, we only had each other upon whom to exercise our violent thoughts and fantasies. This situation was aggravated by the tension that derived from our concern over the installation of an entirely new group of supervisors throughout the company. As most of the lower staff employees realized, it was possible to become accustomed to the violent thoughts and fantasies inspired by a supervisor of long standing, and for precisely this reason, these supervisors would often be replaced in their position because they were no longer capable of inspiring fresh images of violence in the minds of those they were charged with supervising. With the arrival of a newly appointed supervisor, there was inevitably a revival of just the sort of tension that developed into an office atmosphere in which you could barely see a few feet in any direction whenever you were required to move about the aisleways and hallways of the building to which the company had relocated not long before these events, which I have chosen to document, transpired. It was therefore welcome news to employees when it was made known by means of a brief memo from one of the highest members of senior management that none of the murdered supervisors would be replaced and that this position was to be permanently eliminated as part of the scheme for restructuring the company. The relief experienced among the lower staff of the various departments and divisions of the Blaine Company that they would not have to face the prospect of newly appointed supervisors, or supervisors of any kind, since they had all been murdered, allowed the tension, which had been so severe and pervasive, to abate, thereby clearing the air around the offices from its previous condition of a blurry atmosphere of agitation, and also clearing our minds of the violent thoughts and fantasies that we had come to direct so viciously at one another. However, this state of relative well-being was only temporary and was soon replaced by symptoms of acute apprehension and anxiety. This reversal occurred following a company-wide meeting held in the sub-basement of the building where the Blaine offices had been relocated. While the senior officers who called for this meeting readily admitted that a sub-basement in an old and crumbling office building was perhaps not the ideal place to hold a company-wide meeting, it was nevertheless the only space large enough to accommodate the company's full staff of employees and was thought preferable to convening at a site elsewhere in the Golden City, since we would then be required to travel through the yellowish haze, which lately had become far more consistently dense owing to seasonal factors, according to the radio and television reports of local meteorologists. Thus, we all came to be huddled in the dim and dirty realm of the building's sub-basement, where we were required to stand for lack of adequate seating, and where the senior officers of the company addressed us from a crude platform constructed of thin wooden planks, which creaked and moaned throughout this session of speeches and announcements, their words sounding throughout that sub-basement space as hollow and dreamlike echoes. What we were told, in essence, was that the Blaine Company was positioning itself to become a dominant presence in the world marketplace, in the rather vague words of an executive vice president. This declaration struck nearly everyone who stood crushed together in that sub-basement as a preposterous ambition, given that the company provided no major products or services to speak of, its principal commercial activity consisting almost wholly of what I would describe as manipulating documents of one sort or another, none of which had any great import or interest beyond a narrow and financially marginal base of customers, including such clients as a regional chain of dry cleaners, several far-flung restaurants that served inexpensive or at most moderately priced fare, some second-rate facilities featuring dog races that were in operation only part of a given year, and a few private individuals whose personal affairs were such that they required, or perhaps only persuaded themselves out of vanity that they required, the type of document manipulation in which the Blaine Company almost exclusively specialized. However, it was soon revealed to us that the company had plans to become active in areas far beyond and quite different from its former specialization in manipulating documents. This announcement was delivered by an elderly man who was introduced to us as Henry Winston, the new Vice President of Development. Mr. Winston spoke in a somewhat robotic tone as he recited to us the radical transformations the company would need to undergo in order to make or remake itself into a dominant force in the world marketplace, although he never disclosed the full nature that these transformations, or restructurings as they were called, would take. Nor did Mr. Winston specify the new areas of commercial activity in which the company would be engaged in the very near future. During the course of Mr. Winston's address, none of us could help noticing that he seemed terribly out of place among the other members of senior management who occupied that rickety wooden platform constructed especially for this meeting. His suit appeared to have been tailored for a larger body than the bony frame that now shifted beneath the high-priced materials which hung upon the old man. And his thick white hair was heavily greased and slicked back, yet, as he spoke, it began to sprout up in places, as if his lengthy, and in some places, yellowed locks were not accustomed to the grooming now forced upon them. As murmurs began to arise among those of us pressed together in that dim and dirty sub-basement, Mr. Winston's mechanical monologue was cut short by one of the other senior officers, who took the spotlight from the old man and proceeded to deliver the final announcement of the meeting. Yet even before this final announcement was made by a severe-looking woman with close-cropped hair, many of those among the crowd huddled into the confines of that sub-basement had already guessed or intuited its message. From the moment we descended into that lowest level of the building by way of the freight elevator, there was a feeling expressed by several employees that an indefinable presence inhabited that place, something that was observing us very closely without ever presenting a lucid image of itself. Several people from the lower staff even claimed to have glimpsed a peculiar figure in the dark reaches of that sub-basement, a shape of some kind that seemed to maneuver about the edges of the congregation, a hazy human outline that drifted as slowly and silently as the yellowish haze in the streets of the Golden City, and was seen to be of a similar hue. So by the time the woman with the close-cropped hair made what otherwise might have been a striking revelation, most of the lower staff were beyond the point of receiving the news as any great surprise. "Therefore," continued the severe-looking woman, "the rule of those supervisors who have been so tragically lost to our organization will now be taken over by none other than the founder and president of the Blaine Company, Mr. U.G. Blaine. In an effort to facilitate the restructuring of our activities as a business, Mr. Blaine will henceforth be taking a direct hand in every aspect of the company's day-to-day functions. Unfortunately, Mr. Blaine could not be present today, but he extends his assurance that he looks forward to working with each and every one of you in the near future. So, if there are no questions," and there were none, "this meeting is therefore concluded." And as we ascended in the freight elevator to return to our desks, nothing at all was said about the plans revealed to us for the company's future. Later that day, however, I heard the voices of some of my co-workers in conversation nearby the enclosure that surrounded my desk.
"It's perfectly insane what they're doing," whispered a woman whose voice I recognized as that of a longtime employee and a highly productive manipulator of documents.
Others in this group more or less agreed with this woman's evaluation of the company's grandiose ambition of becoming a dominant force in the world marketplace. Finally, someone said,
"I'm thinking of giving my notice. For some time now, I've been regretting that I ever followed the company to this filthy city."
The person who spoke these words was someone known around the office as the Bowtie Man, a name granted to him due to his penchant for sporting this eponymous item of apparel on a daily basis. He seemed to enjoy the distinction he gained by wearing a wide variety of bow ties rather than ordinary straight ties, or even no tie at all.
although there were possibly millions of men around the world who also wore bow ties as a signature of sartorial distinction, he was the only one in the Blaine Company offices to do so. This practice of his allowed him to express a mode of personal identity, however trivial and illusory, as if such a thing could be achieved merely by adorning oneself with a particular item of apparel, or even by displaying particular character traits, such as a reserved manner or a high degree of intelligence, all and any of which qualities were shared by millions and millions of persons, past and present, and would continue to be exhibited by millions and millions of persons in the future, making the effort to perpetuate a distinctive sense of an identity apart from other persons or creatures, or even inanimate objects, no more than a ludicrous charade. It was after I heard the bowtie man proclaim that he was of a mind to give notice that I stepped away from my desk and walked over to join the conversation being carried on by some of my co-workers. "And after you give your notice," I asked the bowtie man, "then what? Where will you go? What other place could you find that would be any different?" Then the woman, whose voice I had previously recognized as that of a longtime member of the company's staff, spoke up, protesting that it was absolutely deranged for the company to imagine that it could ever become a dominant force in the world marketplace. "Do you really think so?" I replied. "Haven't you observed that there is a natural tendency, deranged or not, for all such entities as the Blaine Company, for any kind of business or government or even private individual, to extend themselves as far as possible? To force themselves on the world as much as they can, either by becoming a dominant commercial entity, or merely by wearing bow ties every day, thereby imposing themselves on the persons and things around them, imposing what they are or what they believe themselves to be without regard or respect for anything else aside from how far they can reach out into the world and put their seal upon it, even stretching out into other worlds, shouting commands at the stars themselves and claiming the universe as their own." By that point, I think my co-workers were taken aback, not as much by the words I had spoken as by the fact that I had spoken to them at all, something I had never done apart from the verbal exchanges required by our work as document manipulators. From their expressions, I could see that my speaking to them in this way was somehow monstrous and wrong, a freak happening whose occurrence signified something they did not wish to name. Almost immediately afterward, the group broke up, and we all returned to our desks. That afternoon, the yellowish haze of the Golden City was especially dense and pushed itself heavily against the windows of the building where the Blaine Company had relocated itself. And on the very same day that upper-level management had announced to us that none of the murdered supervisors would be replaced, and that U.G. Blaine himself was going to take a direct hand in the day-to-day operations of each department and division within the company, it seemed that his supervisory presence was already among us. The most conspicuous early sign of what I will call the Blaine presence was the distinct yellowish tint which now permeated the company's office space. Less obvious was the sense which a number of persons had previously experienced during the company-wide meeting that we were all, at times, under the eye of something we could not see, but which was intimately aware of our every word and action. Before the day was over, everyone in the office seemed to have gained a silent understanding of why we had relocated to the Golden City, and why this place, which had once been known as Murder Town, was so well suited to the purposes of commercial entities like the Blaine Company, or was at least perceived to be so by the heads of such corporate bodies. By the following business day, there was no longer any talk around the office about the deranged strategy of the company to become a dominant force in the world marketplace, and no one commented on the absence of the man who wore bow ties each and every day. Perhaps the others actually believed that he had given his notice, a course of action he had suggested he might take, even though none of his personal items had been removed from his desk. Since the supervisor of our department had been murdered, like all the others, there was no one whose duty it was to be concerned with the failure of the bow tie man to show up at the office, just as there was no one who proffered any information about the meaning of his absence. After a few days had passed, his desk was occupied by a new employee, a man who no one had ever seen working elsewhere in the company, and who did not seem like the sort of person any company would hire to manipulate documents. His age was difficult to discern because his face was almost entirely obscured by shaggy strands of unwashed hair and an ample growth of untended beard, both of which were streaked with the discoloration which we noticed affected anything that was subject to long-time exposure to the peculiar atmospheric elements of the Golden City. As for the clothes worn by our new co-worker, they appeared to be very much in the same style as his predecessor who formerly inhabited that particular desk. However, due to the length of the new employee's beard, it was not possible to verify whether or not he was wearing a bow tie each and every day, and no one in the office desired to look close enough to find out if this was the case. Nevertheless, there was one woman whom I overheard telling another that she was going to check on the bow tie man in order to establish what had become of him. Then she herself failed to show up for work the next day. Afterward, no one else pursued the disappearance of either of these two employees, nor that of any of several other employees who, on a fairly regular basis, now began to drop out of the ranks of the lower staff at the Blaine Company, which, by this time, was known to the world simply as Blaine. Needless to say, the degree of tension that now pervaded the offices at Blaine was once again at an extremely high level. Yet this tense environment, which had always served as a hothouse for the most violent thoughts and fantasies among the company personnel, no longer had an effect on the atmosphere of our workplace, such that you could not see more than a few feet in front of your face. Instead, the office space continued to be evenly permeated by a yellowish tint. While I have already identified this distinct yellowish coloration of the office atmosphere with what I have called the Blaine presence, others around me, and throughout the company, held the view that the haze which choked the streets of the Golden City had somehow seeped into the building where we spent each day manipulating documents. But it seemed to me that these differing explanations were in fact complementary. In my view, there was a terrible equation between the Blaine presence, which now supervised every activity throughout the company, even the smallest manipulations of the most insignificant documents, and the yellowish haze casting itself so densely over the Golden City, a place that seemed so well suited to the purposes of commercial entities like Blaine, which of course were merely extensions of the purposes of human entities like U.G. Blaine himself, specifically his seemingly preposterous ambition to turn his business into a dominant force in the world marketplace. All of this remained hypothetical for some time, until, one day, a certain turn of events allowed me to confirm my suspicions and, at the same time, after so much patient restraint, enabled me to pursue my own purposes with respect to the relocation of the company. This turning point came in the form of a summons to the office of the new Vice President of Development, Mr. Henry Winston, who was located in a remote part of the building in which Blaine was the only tenant. Mr. Winston's office, I noted when I first entered, was a sty. Judging by the stained mattress in a corner behind some rusted filing cabinets and the remnants of food and beverage containers scattered about the floor, Mr. Winston had transformed the place into his personal hovel. The Vice President of Development himself was seated behind an old and heavily scarred wooden desk, his arms stretched across the desktop and his head lying sideways upon it in noisy slumber. When I closed the door behind me, Mr. Winston slowly awakened and looked up at me, his hair and beard no longer groomed in the way they had been for the sub-basement meeting at which he spoke some months before. And what he had to say to me now still sounded as though he were reading from a script, although the quality of his voice was far less robotic than it had been at the company-wide meeting. Mr. Winston rubbed his eyes and ran his tongue around the inside of his mouth, catching the aftertaste of the sleep I had disturbed. Then, as if he were a busy man, he got right to the point.
"He wants to have a conference with you. There's a..."
Mr. Winston paused for a moment, apparently at a loss to recall or properly enunciate his next words.
"A proposal. There's a proposal he has for you. A personal proposal."
Mr. Winston then informed me of the time and place for this conference with U.G. Blaine. After the end of that working day, in a lavatory on one of the uppermost floors of the building, this seemed to be everything that the Vice President of Development was required to communicate to me, and I turned to leave his office. But before I was out of the door, he blurted out a few words that genuinely seemed to be his own.
"He should have never brought you here," said Mr. Winston,
which very well might have been his real name. "You mean the relocation of the company to this city?" I replied, attempting to clarify the issue.
"That's right. The relocation," he said, breaking into a little laugh and revealing an incomplete set of yellow teeth.
But he stopped laughing when I looked over my shoulder back at him, focusing my eyes deep into his. "Mr. Blaine isn't entirely responsible," I said. "We both know how it is with this city." After a brief pause, Mr. Winston spoke.
"I know you now," he said, as if speaking softly in a dream. "You were here before, when the sky was clear. What did you do?"
I simply smiled at the Vice President of Development and then exited that squalid office, leaving the man inside with his sleep-polluted mouth hanging open in stupefied wonder. By this juncture in the company's progress, there were no longer many employees remaining who were not of a kind with Henry Winston. One by one, all the regular staff stopped appearing for work, and their desks came to be occupied by new persons who always looked like fugitives from the great tribe of derelicts living in the Golden City, a shadow population that moved day and night through that yellowish haze. No doubt they too had made accommodations for themselves in the building, little havens similar to the one I saw in Henry Winston's office. I imagine that such accommodations and a modicum of food may have been offered to them by the company in lieu of a paycheck. This scheme for cost-cutting would alone account for the elevated profits that Blaine had realized in the past quarter. Of course, this manner of fiscal growth could not continue much longer, and other measures would need to be taken if the company was truly to become a dominant force in the marketplace of this world or any other. These measures, I assumed, would emerge as the chief topic of the conference U.G. Blaine had scheduled with me after the close of the working day in a lavatory on one of the uppermost floors of that crumbling building. When the time came, I began ascending the shaft of stairways, the elevator having ceased to function by that time, in anticipation of my private meeting with the company's president and founder. As I made my way in nearly total darkness up these steps, I recalled the day that I came to interview for my position with what was then called the Blaine Company. That interview took place in another building in another city. In the reception area where I waited to be called for my interview, there hung a portrait of U.G. Blaine. It was a flattering enough likeness of a middle-aged man in a business suit, but the effect of contemplating this portrait was such that I wanted to turn away and purge it from my mind before I started thinking thoughts that I did not want in my head. But I found it impossible to turn away. Fortunately, someone came along and called me to my interview before my thoughts reached a pitch of intolerable tension and agitation. The person who interviewed me asked, among other things, what single personal quality I believed I might possess that would distinguish me for consideration as an employee of the Blaine Company. I hesitated for some time, and even thought it might be best if I gave no reply at all, or a very feeble and conventional response. Instead, I spoke some words that I was sure the interviewer wanted to hear, and that, in fact, were true. "My quality," I said, "my personal quality is the capacity to drive myself and those around me to the uttermost limits of our potential, to affect persons and even places in a way that brings their unsuspected possibilities and purposes out of hiding and into the full light of realization. That is my personal quality." As oddly phrased and vehement as this statement might sound to other individuals, it was, I knew, exactly what my interviewer wanted to hear. On the spot, I was offered the position for which I applied at the Blaine Company, that of a manipulator of documents. When I entered the company's old offices to be interviewed, my only purpose was to lose myself in the manipulation of documents, to bury, as deeply as I could, this passionate personal quality of mine, which had always resulted in the most unfortunate and twisted consequences for those involved. Whether it was an individual person, or a group of persons, or a commercial entity, like the Blaine Company. Because my personal quality, as stated to my interviewer at the Blaine Company, was more than a figure of speech or an exaggerated claim for the purposes of self-promotion, even if I have been at a lifelong loss to account for the full force of this extraordinary quality. For years, my only purpose had been to suppress this quality, to crush it as best I could. However, after contemplating that portrait of U.G. Blaine, after seeing written upon that face what I might describe as a profoundly baseless sense of purpose in the world, everything changed inside my head, which I could no longer keep from filling up with strange and violent thoughts and fantasies. This company will soon need to relocate, I thought, as I walked away from my interview that day. In order to satisfy its sense of purpose as a commercial entity and the baseless sense of purpose of its founder and president, this company will need to relocate to another place. And I knew precisely the place that was well suited to the company's purposes, and to my own. Thus, when I finally located and entered the small lavatory where U.G. Blaine wished to confer with me, I was incited to the point of derangement by the grim drama which was now coming to a climax. "Opportunity awaits you in the Golden City," I shouted, my voice resounding against the tile walls and floor, the metal doors and porcelain fixtures of the antiquated lavatory surrounding me.
Opportunity awaits you in the Golden City, I repeated,
mocking the slogan that a public relations company had used to transform the image of the city once known as Murder Town. It was this preposterous dream of changing its public image that made the Golden City ideal for the purposes of Blaine, the company, which held the deranged and preposterous idea that it could ever become a dominant force in the world marketplace, even though its only commercial activity was that of manipulating documents for small-time businesses and a few private individuals. Only in this atmosphere of a crumbling city surrounded by vast, decaying neighborhoods, its streets filled with hordes of wandering derelicts and permeated by a yellowish haze that no meteorologist or scientist of any kind has ever successfully accounted for. Only in this murder town could I manage to drive Mr. Yuji Blaine to the uttermost limit of his potential, just as I had driven this city itself, whose streets I inhabited for a time, to the vile and devious limits of its potential, leaving behind an inexplicable yellowish haze, a mere side effect of the things that I had done there, things that I was born to do as a freak of this world, or perhaps another world altogether, so unknown am I to myself, things that my freakish nature learned to do over many years, and things that made me seek out my own burial in an occupation where I could forget my freakish self and everything I knew about this world where I did not belong. Only here could Blaine be made to realize his unsuspected possibilities and purposes, especially that baseless sense of purpose which I could not escape seeing in that portrait of a middle-aged man in a business suit. Of course, it was not a man in a business suit who awaited my arrival in that small lavatory. It was the Blaine presence, as I called it, that pervaded the bright little room with its yellowish tint. Your restructuring of the company has been a great success, I said to the Blaine presence, which now quivered and curled about the room in trembling, yellow-tinted waves. Soon, it will be just you and your derelicts in this building. You will be the dominant force in the marketplace of the Golden City, manipulating all the documents in town. But you will never go further than that. This is where you belong. This is where you will stay. And there's nothing either of us can do to change that. You think that I can assist you in extending your power and influence, your marketplace dominance, but I came to tell you that no such thing will ever happen. This place is your uttermost limit. The Blaine presence was now becoming extremely agitated, its yellow tint swirling about the room and batting itself against the walls. There's no use in blaming me for what you are, I screamed. You're the creator of a marketplace for violent thoughts and fantasies. I saw that in the portrait of a middle-aged man in a business suit, and I can feel it in the presence you have now made of yourself. That's all there ever can be for you in this world. At that point, I picked up a waste paper container that stood by the lavatory sink and was shaped like a bullet with a rounded point. Across the room was a small window with panes of frosted glass. I smashed those glass panes by ramming the rounded top of the waste paper container into it with all the violent force within me. Through the smashed panes of that window, in a lavatory on one of the uppermost floors of the building, you could see, out over the city, the moon shining down through the yellowish haze. There, I shouted, while pointing out the broken window. Go out into your world of haze. That's your element now. And you can't survive beyond its limits. The limits of the Golden City. I felt a powerful, almost cyclonic gust sweep past me on all sides, even moving through me as it soared out the broken window and blended into the yellowish haze beyond, leaving behind it a room charged with the residue of vicious and violent impulses. After that night, the Golden City was rechristened as Murder Town. Early the next morning, the streetlights, still shining through the yellowish haze, brutally mauled bodies were discovered lying in every street of the city and far into the vast, decaying neighborhoods surrounding it. For a time, news reports broadcasted by radio and television and printed in newspapers with a dignified image, as well as tabloid rags like the Metro Herald, where I once worked as a reporter myself, were concerned with nothing but these murders, which they called murders of mystery, or mysterious mass murders. However, it was not long before serious consideration was given to the possibility that these were not murders at all, but the consequences of what the Metro Herald designated the Yellow Plague, because the bodies of the victims all displayed jaundiced blotches that overworked hospital personnel, police investigators, and morgue attendants had at first assumed to be bruises caused by violent attacks. For a day or so, city officials had the opportunity to present the cause of these astonishingly lurid and numerous deaths as, quite possibly, an instance of a mysterious disease rather than of a mysterious murder. With the cooperation of local law enforcement and medical officials, along with the services of a sophisticated public relations campaign, the issue of how such an incredible number of corpses might have been produced during a single night could have been confused long enough for the city to waver between its old reputation as a place of murder and an entirely new identity as a place of disease. Of course, given the alternative of henceforth being known to the world as the City of the Yellow Plague on the one hand, or as Murder Town on the other, the latter appellative seemed the preferable choice. apparently unrelated to the mystery murders, according to news reports disseminated by all the local media, was the discovery of the body of a middle-aged man dressed in a worn business suit in a suburb just outside the city limits. Eventually identified as UG Blaine, the corpse was found lying in the parking lot of a small outdoor shopping center. Investigators uncovered no signs that might have connected Blaine's death to those which took place the night before in Murder Town. To all appearances, the man had simply collapsed and died in a place where the yellowish haze of what was once known as the Golden City dissolved altogether, giving way to the lucid atmosphere of an upper-class suburb contiguous with the city's outlying neighborhoods. On that same morning that Blaine's body was found, I walked through the deserted streets of a city where others were still afraid to walk, strolling calmly through the stillness and the yellowish haze. For a moment, I felt that I had finally driven myself to my limit, and I was content as errant pages from local newspapers flapped idiotically along the sidewalk and streetlights glared down upon me. But before the morning had passed, I was ready to move on, to relocate once more. My purpose, for a time, had exhausted itself. But now, I could see there were other cities, other people and places. I could see all the world as if it loomed only a few feet in front of me, its every aspect so clear to my eyes that I would never be able to drive it from my mind until the last of my violent thoughts and fantasies had been fulfilled. Even though I knew in the depths of myself that it was all just another preposterous ambition, a false front propped up by baseless purposes and dreams, I could not help thinking to myself, I have a special plan for this world. May this document, unmanipulated, stand as my declaration of purpose.